are now moving forward to the very first panel of the day, new innovative and cost-effective IT technology for urban banks. Software becomes obsolete with time. What are new and IT technologies in the market? What innovative technologies are there for UCBs? How affordable technologies are? Are the available technologies effective to its core? Are few questions that will be addressed by the panelists. So let me allow to call upon the moderator of this panel, Mr. Vikrant Pongsay. He is CMD on Being Catalyst to take over the conversation. I'm equally delighted to welcome eminent speakers of this panel. Mr. Naren Singh Dawi, he is MD of Adarsh Cooperative Bank, Rajasthan. Welcome to you, sir. Mr. Atul Khilwalkar, he is MD and CEO of Kalyan Janta Sahakari Bank. Welcome, sir. Mr. Madan Gopal Swami, he is MD of Adarsh Urban Cooperative Bank, Telangana. A warm welcome to you, sir. Mr. Suhas Patil, he is Senior Director, Client Engagement, South Asia, Infosys Finacle. Welcome to you, sir. Mr. Kushal Rastogi, he is CEO and Knight FinTech. A warm welcome to you, sir. And Mr. Manoj Chopra, he is Head Innovation and Product Development, Infosoft Technologies. With this, I am handing over the panel to the moderator, Mr. Vikrant Pongsay. Over to you, sir.
Very good morning to everyone. Welcome to the panel discussion on innovative technologies and cost-effective technologies. And today we have an eminent panel with us. In no particular order, I would start with the bankers first. We have Mr. Atul Khilwalkar, who doesn't need any introduction in the cooperative banking space. We have Mr. Madan Gopal Swami, again, no introduction required for most of everyone of us out here. And we have a slightly new member out here, Mr. Dabi, from Rajasthan, joining us from the banker's perspective. And from the technology solutions perspective, we have Suhas Patil, representing Infosys. We have Kushal, again, doesn't need any further introduction out there. And we have Manoj, who is representing Infrasoft. Now, without getting much into it, and these details are available on all the invitations that have come to us, let's get into the panel discussion straight away. I want to have a lot of discussion out here and leave some time for the question answers out there. I would want to structure this discussion in two aspects. The first part being, let us try to understand the problem areas from the bankers first. And of course, the technology experts can also pitch in their experiences, no two ways about it. But the second part, we would look at the solutions to all of these problems that are there. Now, when we talk about innovative technologies, the cost-effective technologies, if you look at it, what's going on, what's happening in the banking space, many multiple things are happening out there, and it's a complete different spectrum altogether. But talking about cooperative banking per se, everything that is glittering out in the banking space probably is not relevant to the cooperative banking. And therefore, this approach of the problem solution and the most important aspect that all the panelists had suggested me was, Vikrant, let there be a great takeaway for all the people and all the audience who are going to listen and going to be privy to this panel discussions. So welcome, my dear panelists, and let's have a very engaging and entertaining session out there. Atulji, I would start with you. Could you just let us know that post-pandemic, now that we are moving into the new era, as we say, the new normal out there, what do you think are the key problem areas for the cooperative banking space? And then we'll come to the next part, if technology can really solve the problems.
Thank you, Vikrant. Thank you, all my colleagues. Probably I may have some limitations because my technology partner is also a panelist here. So that's going to be an issue. But then I'll be talking generically in general as to what are the issues. I personally believe that this COVID has forced the urban cooperative banks to do a lot of introspection in terms of the way they are doing business, in terms of the challenges which are now refreshed. And probably now, I look back to banking prior to 1991 when the reforms have taken place. prior to 1991, virtually the regulator was controlling everything, including the interest rates and everything. So business was virtually directional. The directions were given by Reserve Bank of India. And I should be corrected if I say that we are possibly entering in the similar area now. If you look at the kind of regulations which the Reserve Bank of India is given, from pin to piano, they are asking us to do certain things in a certain way. So there is some encroachment by the regulator on the freedom that we normally enjoy as a banker. Having said that, I personally believe that it is for the good of bank if the regulator is trying to intervene in certain areas. And then the regulator is entering into certain areas without assessing the ground realities. Had the assessment of ground realities been proper, there wouldn't have been any need to have an expert committee of the bankers, retired bankers, and people who have done human service in the urban cooperative banking sector and banking sector in general. Why that expert committee is required? Because the disconnect between the regulator and the banking underground has to be eliminated so that the regulatory guidelines come with the flavor wherein they are easily executable. Since the expert committee has not finalized its recommendation, the meeting process are going on. Like one of our panelists has joined one of such discussion, which I did a couple of weeks ago. So they are doing it with all sincerity. Having said that, this being a technology platform, or this being panel discussion as to where the shoe pinches kind of thing. And I'm going to be very realistic in terms of the urban cooperative bankers, what they are facing and how the technology can help them. That's where our panelists can definitely help us. To start with, I find that the entire urban cooperative banking sector, which has accepted CBS now, post the 2013 guidelines of compulsory or mandatory CBS. Many cooperative banks have done or adopted to CBS, but have not implemented the verticals which are expected to be implemented there in the CBS. Ho gaya, ho gaya. So what next to CBS? Many cooperative banks are yet to complete that. But bank of my size or my caliber, which is virtually equivalent to a commercial bank, and if it is equivalent to commercial bank, what I find is that whatever that the public sector bank is doing, that we are required to do. So whenever I say certain things, there could be a couple of things which are not applicable to smaller or non-scheduled cooperative banks. That is quite possible. But then I would touch upon the issues which are relevant to the entire sector. To start with, the CBS was not compatible to several guidelines which have been issued, and every CBS vendor had to work hard on giving the utilities where the directions could be properly implemented. To start with, last year it so happened that the moratorium was given under COVID-1, and resolution 1.0 was given on 6th of August 2020. We had tough time in syncing with the requirement of the regulator, and the data actually went out. What happened is that there were quite a few anomalies, and we had to outsource certain services from chartered accountants, where they helped us in ensuring that the implementation of the first moratorium request was properly done. And then there was a last minute bomb from Supreme Court of India on 23rd of March, where they said nothing doing, that the ex gratia which you paid in the month of October for the moratorium on interest on interest, you will have to pay it to all the borrowers. But they tweaked around very little on that. So the ex gratia payment in the first part was very simple and straight. In the second ex gratia payment, what they said was this: even the credits that are coming to the accounts are required to be factored while calculating the interest on interest. So whatever utilities that we worked in the first season were not applicable in this second season. So that's where I find that the CBS vendors find it typically difficult. I'm not talking of any particular technology company, because I'm talking of the issues which various other banks are facing. So this is not a vendor specific or a technology specific. In general, banks are still struggling with that area. And for the second ex gratia payment, which came out in the month of March, thankfully, the time limit was not prescribed. So many banks have not yet passed on that benefit to the end consumers is what I feel. Second most important and challenging task for the technologies which I find is that Reserve Bank of India last year has come out with one guideline where they are saying that you have to identify NPAs on ongoing basis. The guidelines in itself is basically flawed. Why it is flawed? Because the things which are into the system can work out and find out the ongoing NPA. There's no issues on that. I mean, that's very plain and simple. But in respect of working capital limits, there are several events which are occurring out of system. And how then the system will mark that account as NPA or otherwise on an ongoing basis. So human intervention is mandatory. But then this is a challenge, I feel, for the technologies where under they can focus on how the working capital limit on ongoing basis they can be identified and the sector can be benefited from them. The third aspect which I would like to focus on that in the month of last quarter of 2021, Reserve Bank of India came out with the guidelines of risk-based internal audit. You will be surprised to know that commercial banks took 10 years to implement these guidelines. As a corollary, it would mean that if you want urban cooperative banks to complete these guidelines by the end of next March, that is March 2022, it's a Herculean task. First and foremost, the urban cooperative banks are short on what to do because the Reserve Bank of India's guidelines are absolutely theoretical. You pick up any book on risk-based internal audit, you will find what the theory about risk-based audit is. How to implement that in the system, there is no practical guidelines. Secondly, this is an opportunity for the vendors as well as the consultants, whereunder they can do a lot of things to help the bank set up the risk-based internal audit system in the organization. It would mean that the risk-based internal audit could have been implemented with a proper bifurcation as tier 1 banks and tier 2 banks. They have not done it. So one bank of a 25 crore business, one cooperative bank of a 25 crore business will also have to implement this and spend money on this. This is illogical. But then the IT vendors who are sitting here need to work out and how they can work out and help the urban cooperative banks in setting up the risk-based internal audit system. That is basically, I visualize this as a migration towards the setting up of a risk management department. For a smaller bank, risk management department may not be insisted upon, but for a bank of say 1,000 crore or more, Reserve Bank of India is insisting not through circulars, but via the inspection that they conduct, that you must have a risk management department. Risk management department, setting up of the risk management department is not an easy function at all, because your entire workflow within the bank at a corporate office undergoes huge change. And then the templates are required to be factored in and the relationship with the sanctioning authority, the credit, the treasury, everything is required to be integrated with the risk management department that I personally believe will take 2 to 3 years. But prior to that, this risk-based internal audit has been introduced with a deadline of 31st of March 2022. Probably that deadline will get extended because urban property banks will find it very tough to do that. The fourth most area which I feel we should look into is that normally garbage in, garbage out is the theorem in terms of technology that exists. What is happening is that all softwares have various lookups and various fields wherein you can classify an account properly. So when a person keys in the basic fundamental details, and if those details are accurately filled up, you can get the priority sector data quickly and accurately. But that is not happening because if I look at my own bank, I have say around 400 employees who are at the clerical level. I have no control as to what kind of data they are inputting, and I have a shortage on actual verification of what kind of data they are verifying or whether the data is accurate or not. So that priority sector lending will now be a critical function, because the quarterly averaging itself means that you will have to run the program and assess the priority sector advances every quarter, which was earlier half yearly, somewhere September and March were the two periods where the priority sector were properly assessed. the six most critical part which I find will be damaging the banks is that the ALM integration, the asset liability management integration and its implications. What has happened, you know, I mean, I'll quote my bank's example. During the last year's inspection, I have a regular ALM system and my vendor has provided me various buckets where under the data can be pooled with an empirical study done on data a couple of years ago. So for me, compiling an ALM return and identifying the variance and gaps and all that issue is over for me. What they are now focusing is that your CBA should identify the variances in the statement itself and whether they are touching upon the tolerance. And if the tolerance is breached, what is your policy that is saying? So this here the technology may not help, but here the banker has to be ready with the policy if the tolerance is breached in respect of interest rate risk or the liquidity risk. Secondly, most important thing the urban cooperative banks are facing these days is the KYC updation, the UCIC, and the blockage of the terrorist names which the Reserve Bank of India dish out every month or 2 months. Fortunately, we have a system where under the names are fed to the system and anybody comes with that name, the account is not opened. So that is the simple risk management that we have done. I do not know whether other banks have done or not. With BR Act coming into place, all cooperative banks, big or small, they are required to follow these guidelines. I do not know if the software vendors or the technologies are in a position to provide some support in these areas. For example, UCIC, why you have an issue of UCIC every month? Because there is a lethargy at the ground level. And then, mere paas ye customer hai, toh main usko naya customer kyun dena chahiye, is the basic funda. But that is not being applied with the proper knowledge. So training and retraining is one of the area that I find very critical. And then one of the question which the panelists were forced to ask is about the software as a service or the software, how the obsolescence in software is evaluated. What I feel is that if your technology partner is updated with the Reserve Bank of India's guidelines and is providing you with the utilities and equipments to be compliant with the regulatory guidelines, the software obsolescence may not be a critical issue, because that can be handled. The urban cooperative banks are not looking for something from the moon. So even if the basic brass tacks are properly provided, urban cooperative banks are happy and they will be able to push it in a proper way. Bank of my size have a technology issues of a different dimension. And therefore, there are 2-3 vendors who are helping me out in solving this apart from my principal vendor. So the principal vendor is with me for the last 30 years, right from the TB operation, this vendor is with me. So we are wedded to this vendor. So these are the issues which I find need to be addressed.
Thank you, Atulji. And I think as a true banker, you have highlighted the pain areas where the shoe pinches, as you rightly mentioned. Mr. Swami, coming to you, what would be your perspective on the pain areas of the urban cooperative banks? I think we don't have Mr. Swami out here. Mr. Dhabi, can I come to you for that matter?